Hey there guys, it's your favorite backyard geographer, this time with a little introductory video on how to interpret contour lines on topographic maps. We know that we live on a dynamic surface with mountains and valleys, and here in California alone we have one of the highest and lowest elevations in the Western Hemisphere. But how can we observe this three-dimensional world on a flat map? Well, we're going to learn how today. Well, the first thing I want to say before we jump into this is I'm using Google Earth Pro along with some topographic maps from the United States Geological Survey. With the help of the tools in Google Earth Pro and looking at the quadrangles from USGS, I'm going to be able to interpret and understand a landscape. So let's jump into that landscape. We're going to be heading into one of my favorite areas along the Eastern Sierra. It's just a little bit north of the Coso Mountain Range into a region called Fossil Falls. So as we can see, this looks just like a volcano, and in fact, it is. It's an extinct cinder cone. And we can see that there's lots of volcanic material and other cones surrounding this region. But nonetheless, we observe and can interpret that this is a three-dimensional mountain. So what I want to do is I want to draw a line. Perhaps my first line that I draw is going to wrap the perimeter of this feature. This line has an elevation of 3,400 feet above base level, or the ocean, sea level. So if I were to walk this yellow line, I would neither go uphill nor downhill. It is of a constant and consistent elevation, and that's the first rule of contour lines, is that every point along a contour line must have the same elevation. Another rule is that contour lines never cross, they never touch, and they must be parallel from one another. Now that's not to say that they can't have designs and curves and points and things like that, but they cannot touch one another. Well, perhaps I add another what we consider an index line or a primary contour line at the 3,600 foot level, which is the green line, and perhaps another at 3,800. I have now created three index contour lines of major elevations. The difference in elevation between them is 200 feet apiece. Now, another rule that we learn about contour lines is that the closer the contour lines are together, the steeper the slope. I often think about this as like stairs. So the steeper and closer the stairs are to one another, the steeper the climb will be. So observing this map, if you follow my mouse, the distance between here and there, it is a great distance, but it's really only a 200 foot interval. But if I come around to this side of the mountain and I were to hike from here to there, I'm still only going to gain 200 feet in elevation. But I'm only able to travel a third of that distance, so it's going to be a lot more steep. Now that I'm observing this, perhaps I can look at this at a slight angle to just kind of get a better perspective of how these contour lines really wrap around our features. So again, I'm able to easily observe that these lines, these contour lines, wrap all the way around the landscape. Well, what if I were to throw a contour map on there? Well, this is what it would look like. Now, obviously, topographic maps or quadrangles are flat, but I'm able to observe both in this case of three dimension and the map. I'm able to see that it's overlaying on one another. Now in this case, I can see that there are lighter lines in between my primary index contour lines, and that's part of our interval. We actually, if you do the math, we find that each line has a value of 40 feet. So from the yellow line to the next line up, that would be a 40 foot interval, which makes sense because if the main index interval is of 200 feet, then these must be broken up into fifths, right? We can also see by looking at this topographic map that we now observe the name of this mountain. It's called Red Hill. And we can also see to the south of that is the Cinder Pits. So again, a few things that we can observe here is that yes, each contour line has its own elevation. It can neither cross or touch other contours. We also know that the closer the lines are to one another, the steeper the topography or the gradient will be. Other things that we can observe, and we'll just move a little bit to the side here, a little bit west. Now we're looking at the Sierra Nevada itself. And I'm going to refresh my topographic map. As again, I'm able to see there's a mountain peak up here at an elevation of 5,832 feet. And I can see these lines that are intersecting the contour lines. Well, those represent rivers. So I've drawn one in for us. So I'm able to see that this line goes all the way downhill and drains out along the alluvial fan into the valley itself. Well, something that we can observe, if we just zoom in a little bit more, is look what happens to the actual contour line itself. We know that it cannot cross. We know that they cannot touch one another. But I'm able to observe a peak. Let me remove the river so we can easily see that. You see that little point? That point, that contour line, is making that shape because a river is incising and is eroding away the landscape. And what this does for the interpreter, us looking at this map, is implies that the point of that V is pointing uphill, or pointing towards the source of which the water is flowing. So I know that this is uphill because these points, these V's, are pointing uphill. Now, on the other side, we can see there's a weird U-shape that develops as well. Well, that bottom of the U-shape implies that the topography is going downhill. So these are yet another tool that we can use to interpret the landscape. I'm able to see that one goes up and one goes down. And let's go to another location here. We're just going to bounce back. We're going to go back to our little volcano that we were observing. And again, I'm going to refresh my maps. And something that's really interesting is right here, you see these little tick marks that are pointing? Those are called hachures, H-A-C-H-U-R-E. And that is a tool that we as cartographers will put on a topographic map to imply that the contour is changing, the elevation is changing. So if I remove my topo map, I can see that this is the dip or a hole inside, like, you know, the caldera, as it were, of a volcano. So by adding those hachure marks, I, as an interpreter, know that this means that this must be a hole, that it's no longer going uphill, because we often assume, again, like down here, that because there's a contour line here and another one there, that it's going uphill, that everything is going uphill. But sometimes you might have a depression along your map. And we use these hachures to remind us that instead of having to put an elevation marker on it, we can go, oh, I observe that there are hachures there, so therefore I know the topography, the contour interval itself, is changing direction. It must be going downhill. So it's another great way or tool that we're able to observe the landscape. I'm going to remove this again one more time. Again, I wanted to just kind of pan around here so we can see some of these great features. So again, we've learned a little bit about the rules of contour lines. Again, why is this important? Well, because if I were to remove the terrain on the landscape and remove all of my little features and contour lines and zoom out again a little bit, and I replace what we know as a 3D or three-dimensional landscape, again with a topographic map, and again I zoom farther out, it's harder for us to interpret this because it's flat. Now, due to shading or relief, we're able to observe some form of dimension to this. In fact, if you notice, this dark red area here is labeled as lava. These are lava bed deposits that have been overlain on top of the surface next to this little lake we have down here. Again, the contour lines imply to us that we can understand the topography. It's a way for us as the interpreter to view a landscape that is otherwise flat on a map into a three-dimensional world. I hope this was helpful. Don't forget to click like and subscribe. And if you have any questions, be sure to comment below, and we'll talk soon.